Fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. Behold, I am alive forevermore.
I am the first and I am the last, and beside me there is no God.
Now I'm going to get on kind of a binge tonight, and some of you are not going to like what I'm going to preach about tonight. It's going to be over your head, some of you. Some of you are not going to understand what all the issues are about and all the roar is about. But I'm going to preach about something I enjoy preaching tonight for a change. I don't always enjoy preaching about everything in the Bible. I'll preach about one of my favorite hang-ups tonight. And so if I get hung up, I may get to stay hung up a long time. And I may say some very wild, offensive things. So you can get ready to get offended, get hurt, and walk out real mad, because it's going to go tonight. It's going to go tonight. I'm going to preach to you tonight on why I believe the King James Bible is the Word of God. if you don't know why or wonder why, you'll be very much upset before the evening's over, because in order to magnify the Word of God, you have to put a lot of things down to a proper level. And when you take all these false gods, the body of Christ, put them down to the proper level, you always get in trouble with somebody. So we're just going to get in trouble. All right, Jeremiah chapter 23 now, and Psalm 119. Now, first of all, Psalm 119, verse 160. Psalm 119, verse 160. There's a psalmist says this. He says, "Thy word is true from the beginning, and every one of thy righteous judgments endures forever." I believe that. I believe the word of God is true from the beginning. Genesis 1. And every one of God's righteous judgments endures forever. All right, you come across there, Jeremiah chapter 23. When you get Jeremiah chapter 23 and pick up about verse 36, you find somebody's mess with that book. In Jeremiah 23, verse 36, so I look right toward the end of that verse, and toward the end of that verse in Jeremiah 23, verse 36, it says, For ye have perverted the words of the living God. That's a charge brought against somebody. That says somebody perverted the words. Somebody perverted the words of the living God. So the living God gave some living words, and Christ said, the words that I speak unto you, they are truth. They are life. They are spirit. They are life. The Lord Jesus Christ said, the word that I speak to you, they are spirit, they are life. And somebody took those living words from the living God and perverted those words. That's what it says. Now you talk about the subject I'm going to talk about tonight, and folks say, well, I'd be just a hobby horse. No, there's no hobby horse about what I'm going to talk about tonight. The subject of final authority is a crucial subject, absolutely crucial to anything going on in America, the world today. If there's one issue that's important anywhere in the world today, it's the issue of final authority. Absolute truth. The fellows up there in the Supreme Court, they say all truth is relative. When they get talking about all truth being relative, they lie like a dog. They say all truth is relative. When the issue comes up about teaching evolution in the schools, they say you can only teach one theory. The only theory of evolution can be taught in the schools is the theory of evolution. Nobody can teach the theory of creationism. It isn't allowed. They stand up there and say all truth is relative, and then they only say one truth can be taught. If all truth is relative, it's more than one truth. And in more than one truth, the kid ought to have access to more than one truth. They're a bunch of liars, a bunch of crooks. Now we're here talking about somebody messing up a book, and we're talking about a timeless subject, and the subject is more important than almost any subject in this world. Now, there are only two religions besides Christianity that believe that a book is the final authority. You take the Roman Catholic, his final authority is the Pope and the Church and the Bible and anything else he wants to make up to get himself through. But you take the Jew professed to be in subjection to a book, the Old Testament. And you take a Muhammad, he professed to be in subjection to the Koran. So Christians and Jews and Mohammedans are the only people in the world that profess to be in subjection to a book. We're the only people that profess to believe in being a subjection of final authority that is a written, printed authority a man get his hands on. A man who is a Mohammedan, a genuine Mohammedan, profess to be in subjection of the Koran. An Orthodox Jew that's an Orthodox Jew the way a Jew ought to be an Orthodox Jew, profess to be in subjection of the Old Testament. A child of God that's a child of God in the biblical sense, professes to be in subjection of the Old Testament and the New Testament. And he says, somebody took those words in that book and somebody perverted those words. Now, I'm going to talk to you tonight about why I believe the King James Bible is the Word of God. And the first thing I want to say about this subject is this. I believe the King James Bible is the Word of God because it's the only book that I have in my library and on my shelf that doesn't have a copyright. Somebody said, what about the Crown copyright back in 1611? I'm not talking about 1611. I'm talking about right now. Folks, you have a time of it. They're always hung up on the originals, the originals. I never worry about the original King James 1611. I worry about the one I've got in my hand. Have you got a Bible in your hand right now? Or if you've got a plain King James Bible there, you've got a book with no copyright on it. Now, if you have some notes in your Bible, it may have a copyright. If you have a Scofield Bible, then there may be a copyright connected with it. If you have a Bible that has maps in it, an index, and references, you may have a copyright on it. But anybody anywhere in the world can go down to the dime store and put the money down there and get a plain King James Bible with no notes, no reference, no maps, no gazetteer, no concordance, and open that thing up, and there's no copyright in it. Now, how do you explain that? Why, it's unexplainable. How do you explain a book sitting here that has no copyright on it when there are 15 million books in the Library of Congress? 15 million books. 15 million books in the Library of Congress, and every one of those things that's printed in this century has a copyright on it. If you wanted to get a copy of any one of the 15 million books in the Library of Congress, I used to say there was 4 million, and I thought I had to adjust myself and make the thing 9 million. Then I had to make a further adjustment when I got the official thing on it from the Guinness Book of Records and the Almanac of Facts and all this and that. I found there were 15 million volumes in the Library of Congress. That's a mess of books, man. 15 million books. And one of them doesn't have a copyright. How do you explain that? If you had to buy a copy of anything in that Library of Congress, it'd come out, a printer would print it, and as soon as he printed it, there'd be a copyright on it. And a fellow said, oh, well, that thing is just to guarantee that nobody misrepresents it. Oh, I don't believe that. Copyrights are for making money. Copyrights are somebody can write and say, can I print that? Yeah, you can for a tidy sum. That's all that stuff is. I believe the King James Bible is the Word of God because it has no copyright on it. You said it has the Crown copyright. It may have the Crown copyright, but you don't have to ask the Crown for the right to print it. In Ecclesiastes chapter 8, verse 4, it says, where the word of the king is, there's power. If it had a Crown copyright, it was copyrighted under a king. If it was copyrighted under a king, it's got the right copyright, because the Bible says where the word of the king is, there's power. I don't have any faith at all in these Bibles printed in America. Translated in America. These little RSVs and ASVs and new ASVs and Weymouth and Moffat, Living Bible and Goodspeed and all that junk. You say, why not? They're not translated under a king. The Bible said, well, the word of the king is his power. Somebody said, well, what's so good about the English? How come they got a corner in the market? They got a corner in the market because that's how God worked it out. I mean, what time is it right now? That's 21 minutes till 7. That clock's off. It's 18 minutes to 7. How many have 15 minutes to 7 when she has? How many have 20 minutes to 7 when she has? How many have 25 to 7 when she has? Well, they're all reliable. They're all good. You see how people are? You see how people are?
Yeah.
There's only one correct time on the face of this earth. It's English time. I don't say that because I'm a limey. I don't care about the liners. I just assume it'd be Berlin time or Vienna time. I don't care about London, and tea, a spot of tea in the afternoon, fish and chips, old boy. I don't care about that junk. But it just happens to be English time. If you've got English time, you've got the right time. If you don't have English time, you've got the wrong time. All time this earth is settled by Greenwich, England. There's a zero line run right down. If you've got Greenwich time, you've got the right time. If you haven't got English time, you've got the wrong time. I got a real nasty letter from a Puerto Rican one time, wrote me real upset about all this stuff. And he said, what do you mean with all this English stuff? You're a white supremacist, WASP and all this and that. He said, what about us folks down in Puerto Rico here? We had a Bible before the King James Bible came out, all this English stuff. I guess he thought I was an Englishman or something. I wrote him back, and I was just feeling kind of nasty that day. And I wrote back, and I wrote him back, and I said, listen, I said, if it weren't for England, we wouldn't know where you're at. I mean, longitude and latitude are given to every airplane in the air and every ship on the sea by the equator in England. Pensacola, you can't even locate Pensacola that fine in England. If you fired a distress call and said, I'm at such and such a place, they say, what's the longitude? What's the latitude? And, brother, you give England as a mark. Now, how do you explain that? Absolute location is English location. Absolute time is English time. Why would you think that absolute truth wasn't English truth? Strange stuff going on these days. I believe the Bible is the Word of God because it's the only book I've ever seen or got a hold of that isn't copyrighted. You say, well, how do these other people believe the Word of God, Ruckman? Why do you think you're the only person who believes the Bible is the Word of God? I don't. I think most common, ordinary Christians believe that book is the Word of God. I believe you have to be educated out of it. I believe every man who ever got saved in this country believed that word was the Word of God the first time he ever saw it. I don't care if you got saved through reading the Living Bible or got saved through hearing Billy Graham preaching ASV, when you picked up a King James Bible, the Holy Spirit told you, that's it, right there. And if you don't believe that right now, it's because somebody has educated you out of it and talked you out of it. I mean, I went off to school, you know, they tried that. I went off to school with those professors, they majored in talking young men out of their belief in the Word of God. And they worked at it overtime. They didn't get anywhere with me. You say, what? Just bullheaded? Just bullheaded. There's some advantages about being bullheaded. And that's one of them, brother. If you get a hold of the truth, you don't let it go just because 300,000 saps offer proof that it isn't the Word of God. It don't impress me one way or another. If I had this room right now filled with the faculty full of Bob Jones, the faculty of Tennessee Temple, and the faculty of Harold Anderson, the faculty of Piedmont, and Pillsbury, and Maranatha, and Northeast, and Mid-South, and Midwest, for Southeast, and Pacific Coast, and Bible Baptist Central, and Moody, and Fuller, and Wheaton, they couldn't get my fender, boy. You say, why? I'm fixed. I'm rooted. I know what the Word of God is. I've got it. No jackass gonna talk me out of it. Praying around the pastor, flaunting his education in front of me, I'm not impressed. I was up here to meet recently, and the guy told me, he said, did you know recently that so-and-so, he named a friend of mine, he said, you know so-and-so recently tried to get a debate going between you and Bob Jones Jr.? And he told Bob Jr., he said, if you and Ruckman have such a problem, why don't you invite Ruckman up here to face this student body at Bob Jones and let him debate Wisdom and Pinoza and Custer. Said, you got him 3-1, why don't you invite him up there and have him debate up there? And Jones said, my God, no, you couldn't win an argument with him, he's too smart. Well, that's some confession to make. If I'm not smart, why don't you believe what I believe about the book? Why, you wouldn't catch me admitting that. I wouldn't say why those fellows are smarter than I am. If I thought they were smarter than I was, I'd believe what they believe. All this stuff, brother. I believe the King James Bible is the Word of God because there's no copyright on that book. That isn't all. I believe that King James Bible is the Word of God because the time in which it first appeared on the scene of this world. When that King James Bible first showed up, I know history. I know what was going on in history. That King James Bible showed up, there are a number of things that weren't around that are around today. For example, that King James Bible showed up, and those fellas sat down there, those godly men, that's what they call them themselves. I guess I can call the King James translator that too. They sat down there and called themselves godly men. When the King James translator sat down there to translate that book and turn that book out, French atheism was not in vogue. German rationalism was not in vogue. English deism was not in vogue. All the trouble, all the objections, the Word of God came up after the King James Bible came out. Every one of them. I know history and I know what's going on, and that's what went on. That's what went on. The French Revolution hadn't taken place yet. The French atheists hadn't taken over yet. You take the German rationalists, they hadn't taken over yet. They were still going by Martin Luther's Heiliger Schrift. You take the English deists, the Lord Hubert and Holmes and Hobbes and that bunch, they hadn't Bolingbroke, they hadn't showed up yet. It was translated a time in history when God the Holy Spirit could work and get a hold of some men and get them to produce a work that they believed in because all that stuff wasn't going on. While these new Bibles, when these new Bibles are printed, any one of them, an ASV, an RSV, a new ASV, when they're printed and turned out, the fellows who are sitting down that committee are literally infected and diseased with infidelity. Any of them. You take Jack Hiles preached up one time up at Jerry Falwell School. When he got through preaching up there, they went back to the classroom again to talk about it. And one student said to his teacher, said, well, Brother Hiles, He said this about the King James Bible, and he implied the King James Bible was inspired. And the teacher said, well, you know what the Bible says? The Bible says, he knew not whereof he spoke. And then told that young man in the class, after all, here's a contradiction. It says here Jehoiakim was 8 years old when he began to reign. It says over here Jehoiakim was 18 years old when he began to reign. There's a contradiction right there. Barak was a fellow in a classroom at a fundamental school creating an infidel in the classroom. You say, was that Liberty Baptist University that advertised as the greatest Bible Institute course in the world and makes no bones about it and said their Bible Institute course is absolutely unequal when it comes to learning the Word of God? Blow it out your nose, fella. I mean, sit there in the classroom and tell them the kid that contradicts and that isn't creating a Bible Institute believer. That's creating infidels. You say, what's the trouble? These fellows, they sit down these modern Bible committees, they're shot through with infidelity. They can't take their heads, they're just buzzing with bees, man. They got bees in the bonnet. They're droids. Wimps. Here comes this new translation. What's it about? Oh, it's about $4.95. Have you read this latest book by Zodiades in the original Greek? You can hardly wait to get through the introduction before you put it down. Well, out here on the Pacific Coast, Living Bible is selling like wildfire. They're burning them. That's what they ought to do, all this junk. I believe the King James Bible is the Word of God because of the time and history in which it appeared. I tell you something else I believe about it. I believe the King James Bible is the Word of God because of the promise God made of preserving His Word. He said back in the Psalm chapter 12, he said, the word of the Lord are pure words. They're like gold tried in the furnace of earth and purified seven times. Thou wilt preserve them this generation even forever. God Almighty said he preserved that book, and he preserved that book forever. I don't think a bunch of infidels won't take it away from me. If I want to find it, there must be some place that I can find it. Now, these fellows up there, Bob Jones, you're talking about these things. They say, why, God Almighty, he couldn't inspire a translation. I never said the King James Bible is inspired, but I've kind of broadly intimated it at times. And that Bob Jones, they say, why, Ruckman teaches this heresy of double inspiration. A translation can't be inspired. Why, good people, in the New Testament, there are more than 40 quotations from the Old Testament. The Old Testament is written in Hebrew. The New Testament is written in Greek. And when Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Peter, James, and Paul, that one sat down to write and wrote down and quoted the Old Testament, they had to translate from Hebrew to Greek to write down the translation. When Luke said, thus was fulfilled by the prophet, quote, he's quoting Hebrew. And he's writing the Hebrew down in Greek. And if you can't inspire a translation, then what Luke wrote down, the original is not even inspired. Because what he wrote down is a translation back there. Did you ever go there in Matthew where he said, that was fulfilled by the prophet, a virgin shall conceive and bring forth a son, he shall be called Emmanuel, which is God with us? He's quoting Isaiah. What's Isaiah written in? Hebrew. What's Matthew writing in? Greek. He's translating. Why, if you can't inspire a translation, you can't even count on the New Testament in Greek. Because it's a translation from the Old Testament Hebrew. He said, where did that stuff come from, Bob Jones University? My, what a bunch of brains. What a bunch of brilliant people. Why, oh, they're smarter than I am. Why, spitting the whole bunch one time, I drowned the whole bunch. Amen, 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 amen. And folks say, who do you think you are? Who do they think they are? I get sick and tired of folks around. Oh, Ruckman thinks he's right and everybody else is wrong, you know. Oh, Ruckman's so critical. Ruckman's always down on this. Shut your mouth, you hypocrite. How come I have never heard you talk about them down on the Word of God and criticize? Why is that? They tear up that book and kick that book around and criticize that book and think they're smart enough to mess with that book, and then you get upset with me because I correct them? That shows whose side you're on. You say, well, I just don't believe that book is that real, that true, and that good. Well, you and the devil agree on that. You may disagree with some other thing, but you're together there, brother, sister. All this business. I believe the Bible is the Word of God because of the promise of preservation. You mean to tell me I can't get a hold of the Word of God? You mean to tell me I can't get a hold of the words of God? Boy, if I can't get a hold of the Word of God and can't get a hold of the words of God, I sure am in one flat-footed mess, now ain't I? Christ said, if a man love me, he'll keep my words. You love him? How do you keep his words if you don't have them?
Christ said, if a man wants something, if you keep my word, he'll ask what he will. How do you get a prayer problem if you don't keep his words? You know what Christ said? Christ said, he that is of God heareth God's words. You hear them not because you're not a God. Do you hear the words of God? How do you hear them if I'm not giving them to you, if you don't have them? So all that stuff, that Bible says, that preacher in 2 Timothy, preach the word, preach the word, preach the word. What? Preach something you don't have? He said, preach the word. He said, if you're of God, you'll listen to it. And he lost it. Rather careless of him, don't you think? I mean, to verbally inspire this book and then forget the thing and leave the thing and lose the thing? Ain't good thing he don't preach you salvation like that now, ain't it?
Yeah, that's right.
Did he give you the new birth?
No.
Are you still born again?
No.
Oh, how do you know? Maybe it's a copy of a copy of a translation. Maybe it got lost somewhere in the thing. I mean, who knows? Who knows, brother? How many of you been saved more than 20 years? Let me see your hands. How many saved more than 30 years? Let me see your hands. You mean to tell me God can preserve you? You believe God can preserve what he did? Did he write a book? Can he preserve it? Amen, amen, amen. Amen, amen, amen. I be the King James Bible, the Word of God, because of the instruments of its preservation. You say, who's that? That silly vassal King James? Well, he might have been a silly vassal, but he wasn't as dumb as the fellow who translated the new ASV. He might have been a silly vassal, but he at least knew the right manuscripts. When he saw a bunch of manuscripts there, they had the Apocrypha in the Old Testament. He said, that's wrong. Put them between the Testaments. Ain't supposed to be part of the Old Testament. He had more sense than the faculty of Bob Jones do. Well, the faculty of Bob Jones, they recommend the Westcott and Hort Greek text. That is according to what they wrote in their literature right here. And the Westcott and Hort Greek text are Sinaiticus and Vaticanus. And Sinaiticus and Vaticanus have, guess what, in the Old Testament? The Apocrypha as part of the Old Testament. You hear them keep finding fault with the King James. Somebody says, well, the King James Bible has the Apocrypha in the Old Testament. No, it doesn't. It has the Apocrypha between the Testaments. They'll lie about it. King James may have been God's silly vassal, but he had more sense than that committee. King James may have been God's silly vassal, but I'll tell you one thing. He had better sense than to have somebody bow down and call him Holy Father. And that's more you can say for some pot-bellied liquored heads. I mean, he might have been God's silly vassal, you know, and all this and that. May have fell off the horseback and played tennis on Sunday, but at least he didn't have people call him the vicar of Christ. You got to admit he had more sense than that. I told some of you going to get real upset before this summer's over. Now, I'm not off the ground yet. I'm not on a hanger yet. We're just getting the motors warmed up along about in here. I be with the word of God because the instruments of preservation. Somebody said, well, I just don't like the way they bragged about King James and that Bible. Why not? Doesn't the Bible tell you to be in subjection to the powers that be? Doesn't the Bible say, fear God and honor the King? Doesn't the Bible say in Romans chapter 13, the powers that be are ordained of God? You know, these little articles written by Moody Monthly, you know, in Faith Magazine, the Fundamentalist Journal, talking about how these King James translators bootlick King James, you know, and made such a fuss over him when he was such a sorry character. How many of you have read that stuff? Let me see your hands. Sure you have. You're doing the reading. Always making fun of King James, talking about what a sorry character he was, how the King James families were afraid of him and butted him up and called him, you know, all these high and mighty titles. Well, listen, that Bible says, fear God and honor the King. Honor the King. When Peter said honor the King, that was written to Nero, a half-mad murderer. First Epistle of Peter, fear God, honor the King. Nothing wrong with those King James families honor their King. They're obeying God when they honor their King. The powers that be are ordained of God. I've got faith in the instruments of preservation because I know their attitude. I've read the prefaces to their book. Some reading you ought to get done sometime, if you ever have time to do any, is a reading of prefaces. A preface is what a fellow says before he begins to write. Did you ever read the preface of the King James Bible, the introduction to the dedicatory, where those fellows sit there and they say, "We're poor instruments to make God's holy word known." Did you ever read the preface of the ASV? I have. Did you ever read the preface of the Living Bible? I have. Did you ever read the preface of the New King James Bible? I have. I read that preface of where, by the New King James Bible, now for the first time in 370 years, the Word of God is clear. Ah, you dirty, godforsaken, lying reprobate. You go kick your grandmother, okay? Now for the first time in 370 years, it's clear. Ask 4 million converts of Moody how unclear it was. Ask a million converts of Billy Sunday how unclear it was. Ask 4 million converts of George Whitfield and John Wesley how unclear it was. Ask a million converts of Bob Jones Sr. and J. Frank Norris how unclear it was till New King James Bible came along. It's perfectly clear. God says, my words are all plain to him that understands. Proverbs chapter 8, verse 8. There's no problem in it. Your problem is you lack understanding. See? He didn't say you lack education. He didn't say you lack intelligence. He said you lack understanding. You can have understanding without intelligence or training. And you can have intelligence and training, education, not have a lick of understanding. Amen, amen, amen. The Bible says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the Bible says to depart from evil is understanding. That's clear. Although my words are all plain to him, I have understanding. I've studied the instruments for preservation. I've compared with what the other fellows have to say. I've got back at my desk a little magazine by Bob Jones called The Projector. And The Projector says it gives three qualities essential for Christian leadership. Now, one of those qualities is belief in any Bible, the Word of God. I think one of those things is perseverance, you know, and one of them is loyalty, and one of them is honesty, or some other fool thing like that. And there they are trying to train Christian leaders of men and women, and training Christian leaders of men and women, they don't even give belief in the Word of God as an essential for a Christian leader. You know what it's going to produce? It's going to produce some Christian leaders that don't believe the Bible, the Word of God. I believe the King James Bible, the Word of God, because the instruments of its preservation. I'll tell you something else. I believe the King James Bible, the Word of God, because the honesty of its preservation. That is, when those fellows came to a word that wasn't in the Greek or Hebrew and had to add an English word to make sense, they put it in italics. So, I mean, what do you think about the italics in the King James Bible? The italics of the King James Bible are a mark of the man who does the translating is an honest man. When he came across there and knew he had to put something in to make it make sense, he put it in italics so you know it wasn't in the Hebrew, it wasn't in the Greek. That means it's an honest translation. And these Bibles that don't have it in italics and don't have any italics in them are fellows who've added to the Word of God without letting you know where they added to the Word of God. The King James Bible is an honest translation. You say, what about adding the Word of God like that? Well, when they add, they let you know where they added so you wouldn't think it was the Word right there. And sometimes you have to do that. Anybody knows that. You can pick up any Bible on this earth and look through it, and you'll find there are place after place after place where if you didn't add a verb or add something, it wouldn't make any sense at all. The idiom change. You said you believe God led him and guided him in that? Yeah, I sure do. I sure do. Matter of fact, I know he did. You say, how do you know that? I read one time over there in 1 John chapter 2 that if a man denies the Son, he denies the Father. And I read if he confessed the Son, then he had the Father also. And it was half the verse from the italics. Half the verse. When the King James translator sat down and came to that verse, they couldn't find half the verse. But they said, seems to me like it belongs there. So they wrote it down in italics. You know what happened? 200 years after they wrote that thing down, they found Greek manuscripts. You know what was in the Greek manuscripts? The half of the verse they put down in italics. You better watch that book. You better watch that book. Comes along there and talks about speaking an unknown tongue. Somebody said, well, that word unknown is not in the original. You mean you haven't found the copy that's got it yet? Better watch that stuff. I believe the King James Bible is the Word of God because of the instruments of its preservation, because of the honesty of its preservation. A fellow wrote a book one time called The King James Translators versus Dr. Ruckman. His name is Provan, and he said, the King James translators repute Dr. Ruckman. Dr. Ruckman said the King James Bible is infallible. The translators didn't claim to be infallible. Dr. Ruckman said there's no B.C. Septuagint. The King James translators said there is a B.C. Septuagint. Therefore, the King James translators repute Dr. Ruckman. Well, Dr. Ruckman repudiates them, too. I'm not a baby sprinkler. Some of them were. Do you believe in baby sprinkling?
No.
Why, no. Some of them did. God used them in spite of their sins. Yeah, see? Come across there and say, well, they didn't claim to be inspired. Neither did Matthew. Why, listen, there's only one place in the New Testament that speaks about inspiration. When it does, it isn't a reference to anything like that anybody wrote. The only thing says, all Scripture is given inspiration of God. Where did Matthew say his writing was Scripture? Want to find it for me? Where did Paul say Romans was Scripture? Would you show it to me? Well, where does Luke say that what he's writing is Scripture? Show it to me. I read that book through. Scores and scores of time. James never says once he's writing Scripture. Simon Peter never says once he's writing Scripture. He says no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation, but he don't say what the Scripture is. Why, just because the King James translator didn't profess to be infallible, what does that mean? It don't mean nothing. Why, the fella, whoever wrote Leviticus didn't profess to be infallible. The King James translators repudiate Ruckman. Ruckman repudiates them, too. I'm not post-millennial. Some of them were. I don't sprinkle babies. Some of them did. Well, these fellows think, well, if you believe the King James Bible is the Word of God, then you've got to accept everything the King James translators accepted. No, you don't. No, you don't. No, you don't. Well, let me ask you this. Was David a man after God's own heart?
Amen.
Well, he committed adultery and murder. Are you going to follow the same example? Was Noah a preacher of righteousness?
Yes.
You going to go out and get drunk and show him what a fine follower you are? The King James translators believe in babies, sprinkle them. You going to go out and sprinkle the babies? You saw people are? Listen, David wrote over half the Psalms. You can believe what he wrote, amen? Can you practice what he did? Of course not. I'm not interested in what the King James translators thought about their product. I'm interested in the product. And I've got the product. You say, Ruckman, you profess to have the words of God? Yes. You profess to have the Word of God? Yes. You profess to have the words and the Word? Yeah, the words and the Word. You said that book contained the Word of God? Uh-huh. And is it the Word of God, too? Uh-huh. Does it have the words of God? Yes. Does it got all of them? Uh-huh. That book. I believe the King James Bible is the Word of God because of the honesty of its preservation. Why, I'll tell you something else. I believe that Bible is the Word of God because of the dishonesty of its critics. I've studied its critics. I've made a lifelong habit of studying its critics. That probably has soured my preaching a good bit. I'd probably be a lot more pastoral in my preaching, a lot more spiritual in my preaching, if I hadn't spent so much time studying these fellows. Because you study them, you get a burr under your saddle, boy. It makes you buck the horse. But you know what? One reason why I believe that King James Bible is the Word of God? Because of the pride and inconsistency of its critics. I've studied its critics for years and years. I have never in my life, not in my life, in studying the Mafia, the Cosa Nostra, the Syndicate, I have never in my life studied a more crooked bunch of dishonest, unethical people than the people who put out those new translations recommend. They're the biggest crooks in the face of this earth. Amen, amen. I mean, the pride, the inconsistency. I got a letter back there from Truman Dollar. Dear Brother Ruckman, anytime I can help you, please let me know. I realize you're off on the wrong track, and I honestly believe you're doing more harm to the cause of Christ than any other preacher in America today. If you come by sometime here in Kansas City, I'd be glad to talk with you about these matters, Brother Dollar.
Thank you, Daddy.
We wrote him back a letter. I had the Board of Trustees sign it. It said, Dear Brother Dollar, anytime you want to come by here, we'll put you in Holiday Inn, give you an honorarium, give you 50 minutes from the pulpit Sunday morning to tell our people why Ruckman is doing more damage to the cause of Christ than he preached in America. My people behave like gentlemen. Nobody argue back with you. Nobody talk with you. Well, let you have 50 minutes to state your case. You think he answered? Not a peep. Not a peep. Why, listen. If I thought a fellow was doing more damage to the cause of Christ than any man in America, and invited me 50 minutes in his pulpit,
yeah,
you think I wouldn't take it?
Yeah.
Well, I'd pay my own hotel bill, man.
Yeah.
He wouldn't have to get a Holiday Inn for me. I'd buy my own round-trip ticket and buy my meals.
Yeah.
So what's the difference between you and those people? I'm over the plate waist high.
Amen.
That's the difference.
Amen.
And these fellows are always like this. It's always like this. I got up to Baptist fundamentalism in 19... What was it? 19 what? How'd the years go by? Brother, you were there. What year was it? How about you? What year was it? Three? Okay. 83. We were up there in 83 and got up there, that Baptist fundamentalism. I was going on shaking hands with Bob Gray and Monroe and Harold Wong and some of my friends. And I had an unguarded moment. I was walking by a platform and a guy suddenly stuck his hand out in front of my stomach where I couldn't avoid it and shook my hand. It was Truman Dollar. They said, glad to have you here, Brother Ruckman. Good to see you here.
Yeah.
I stepped back and and figured, I wonder where I can wash my hand. I mean, imagine telling a fella you're doing more harm to the cause of Christ than I am in America, and then taking his hand and saying, very glad to have you here. Why, you wretched, lying, dirty, low-down, miserable, two-faced, split-tongued, double-tongued, two-headed rascal, you. You know why he did that? A bunch of my buddies are standing around there. Why, I think I'm a friend with good old Dollar. What a character, man. Let me tell you something. If I lived like that, I couldn't look myself in the mirror when I got up in the morning. I would say a guy like that shaves without cutting his throat. And you say, what is that? Those are critics of the King James Bible. That fellow was on the new King James Committee, Truman. And Truman Donald was on there, and he didn't want to have people know he was on there, and acted like he wasn't on there, and then they caught and found out that he was on there. All that stuff. I put an article in the paper one time, and my wife said he phoned up the next week and gave me the phone. I was totally unprepared for it. I mean, I'm not used to people hate my guts, you know, hanging around trying to make contact. I try to kick them in the bushes hard enough so they don't come back 8 or 9 years. But he phones up, and that phone says, well, Brother Ruckman, I was up all night last night. I was praying about something, and I was, the Lord just dealt me about it, and I wanted to phone and apologize to you. And I said, well, it's okay. There's no skin off my nose. I don't worry about anything. And he said, well, I said some very bad things about you. I said, don't give it to me. Take it or leave it. And he said, but the Lord just dealt me about it, and I wrote you a very nasty letter, and it says some very hard things about you. I said, don't make it to me. Forget it. And he said, well, the Lord just told me to apologize for writing these things, and I know you're very strong. And I thought myself, oh, pew, what a fuss. I couldn't figure out talking with a woman or what, you know. I know you're very strong. Man. I told my wife, I said, listen, when that letter comes in, if it ever comes, did it ever come in? I told her to throw it out. So she did. She threw it out. And I said to her, when things was over, I said, what in the world do you suppose that guy phoned up about? And she said, well, can't you guess? I said, no, that stuff too. I'm not that, man, I'm plain fella, see? I got friends who know who they are, I got enemies who know who they are. I got enough friends to be happy enough enemies to keep me awake. Like playing butt ball, a guy said, who's on whose side? I said, stick around, you find out. And I said, but what's all this stuff about this letter? She said, don't you know? I said, what? He said, he didn't want you to print it. Well, I should have thought that, you see. I didn't think of that. That's why. He talked that phone call and get so I wouldn't print it. I didn't print it. I'm not going to print it. But I'm not going to print it because of worrying about him. I'm not going to print it. So I'm so disgusted, man. My stomach's turning, man. And I got a strong stomach. If a guy hates my guts, okay, fine. Oh, fine. I got an enemy? Good. You're my enemy? Good. I like a mark. Friends here, enemies here. But this, so glad to meet you. I'm so sorry. The Lord took... Shut your cotton-picking mouth, man. The guy's no friend of that book, and I'm no friend of his. All right, give a fellow a chance to come down here and talk. I mean what I say. I'm up politicking. Bring it on down, man. We gave Custer the same thing. Custer put out a little article there, you know. Ruckman ran off and left his wife, you know, and Ruckman did this and Ruckman did that and so forth and so on. And we wrote him a letter and signed it. And said, come on down. We'll give you 50 minutes from the pulpit Sunday morning. We sent him a registered letter, man, some certificate. They got to sign that thing if they get it. We get the slip back saying they signed it. They got it. You say they show up? No, they never show up. You say why? Because they're just as crooked as a double-headed rattlesnake. That's why. And they're saved. They're saved. You know, I didn't say they're lost. I said they're fine, good, godly, dedicated, crooked thieves. Liars. Oh, the pride. Oh, the inconsistency. So proud. Oh, Ruckman thinks he's right. Ruckman criticizes everybody. Oh, Ruckman thinks he's so smart. Ruckman's the egomaniac. I never thought I was smart enough to correct that book. They're smart enough to correct that book. Boy, they're smarter than I am. Well, they think they are. Somebody said, egotism is the hypodermic that God allows a fool to use on himself to deaden the pain. I believe that, brother. All this stuff. Why, you take up at Bob Jones University, you know what they have a sign under the pulpit. Pulpit set up right here and right back here. Mind the pulpit, a little sign. And the sign says, please use nothing but a King James Version from this pulpit. And when a speaker comes in there like they do at Bible conference, he sees that sign, and he may have been using ASV all his life or recommending a new ASV. When he gets in that pulpit, he pulls out a King James. When he finishes, 4,000 young men and women in that building are deceived into thinking he believes that book because he was told to use it. Just as crooked as a dog's hind leg. You don't see any sign up here saying use a King James. You say, well, you wouldn't let mine in the pulpit doesn't use a King James. Sure I would. We've done it. Accidentally, we've had guys up here use other versions. I don't run up in the pulpit and say, get down, that's heresy, get down, you can't use that. I'll sit there. Why, if a guy gets here and uses some other version, I don't have to say anything. You people start going. Here, no, he's in the wrong pew real quick. I don't worry about those kind of things. Oh, Ruckman believes you don't believe the King James Bible, the Word of God, you're going to hell. How many ever heard that? Let me see your hands. Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. Boy, some of you folks don't get around very much, do you? That's what's happening now in this country. Ruckman says if you don't believe the King James Bible, the Word of God, you're going to hell. I never thought such a thing a day in my life. I'd never even told you how to use a King James Bible. Have I ever told anybody at this school you had to use a King James Bible? This school has been open for 18 years. I've never told one student you got to use a King James Bible. If you want to buy the other translations, buy them. It's a free country. Help yourself, man. No skin off my nose. You want to cut your own throat? That's your problem. I mean, I'm not going to fool with them. I've got old saints all over this country praying for me. I got men and women all this country, 80 and 90 years old, praying for me every day of the week. You think I'm going to let them down, lose all them prayers? I know when I'm well off. Stick with the book, brother, stick with the book. Oh, the pride, oh, the inconsistency of these people. At Tennessee Temple, we use nothing but the King James Bible. Here's a good one right there. Isn't that a beauty? That's the sword of the Lord. That's the sword of the Lord. This is what you missed by not attending Hiles Anderson College. You want to see what you all missed? All right. You missed recreation at a six-lane bowling center. And an indoor miniature golf course. Ooh, boy. And a 3,000-seat gymnasium. Boy, what you ever missed? And you would have missed attending classes on a beautiful 90-acre wooded campus where you wouldn't have to go outside to go from dormitory to the chapel dining hall because all the buildings are connected by lighted and heated hallways. And you had to walk in the rain. And had to walk around the corner of the building with the wind blowing on you. Think what you missed. We ought to give you a free chapstick. And I told you it's going to be a long night. Now I am enjoying myself because I've had to deal with this all my life, and I'm going to have to deal with the day I go home with judgment. And God giving me grace, I'm going to put on the pressure harder than I ever have put it for in my life. 13. You would have been taught the Bible where only the King James Bible is used in the classroom. How about that? Why, he's a Ruckmanite. Why, we're not that fanatical. You fellas been here for 3 years. Haven't you seen us use more than a King James Bible in the classroom? I never saw you so fanatical all my life. You, the King. Now, you know what's wrong with that bunch of hypocrites? They use what they don't believe. Down here, we use anything. Well, but believe one. Up there, they use one and believe anything. You got that? You know what they are? They're inconsistent. They're inconsistent. That's the most inconsistent thing I ever heard of in all my life. To use a book you don't believe. Apostle, we believe the King James Bible is good, but the ASV is better, then why don't you use it? Why don't you use it? If it's better, why don't you use it? Why give your people second best? God help you people, if I thought the King James Bible was not as good as some other one, I'd give you one I thought was best. I wouldn't lie to you. You know what I've got against these fellows? They're liars. They're lying. I've nothing against the man except quit your lying. I know why people lie. They lie because they're afraid. Every time you ever lied, you're a liar. It's because you're scared. Can't you kids say amen to that? Let me say amen, buddy. Amen. You're scared. That's why you lie. You lie because you're scared. I want to ask you something. In God's name, what is a man doing standing in a pulpit that's called to preach and believe the book and has a congregation full of people who believe the book? What is he scared about? Yellow belly stuff up there at that World Congress or whatever it was we went to, or Baptist Fundamental, whatever it was, that extravaganza, that mess. The first fellow got on to speak was Wendell Zimmerman. They gave him for his subject the authority of the Word of God. And he got up there and flew around the land of script 3 hours, never landed. He never got anywhere. He just messed and messed and messed. And that bum must have been about five speakers later, Bob Gray got up. And Bob Gray wasn't even supposed to speak about that. He's supposed to speak about something else. And that Word of God in him was just burning him to where he's about to explode. He hadn't opened his mouth 5 minutes, then he said, "You talk about a Baptist heritage. Our Baptist heritage is this King James Bible." And put it up. And when he hit that crowd, roared, "Amen." Well, then Zimmerman had nothing to be afraid about to start with. What's all the yellow belly stuff for? You know what they advertise themselves as? Militant fundamentalists. Militant. You know what militant is? That means fight. Bunch of gutless soldiers standing up there. After Bob Gray waved that book around the air, every other fella got up after that would wave his book around the air. Had to wait for some little old Florida preacher to show them how to behave themselves. What a disgusting performance. I believe that's English. What a disgusting performance, oh boy. It's a rotten performance. I believe the King James Bible is the Word of God, and for no other reason than the pride and inconsistency of its critics. What I mean by that? I mean, you can tell as much about a man by a man, by his enemy, as you can by his friends. If I want to find a fellow what a fellow's like, you know what I do? I find out who his friends are, then I find out who his enemies are. When I got the man's friends, I got his enemies, I know the man. A man that doesn't have any enemies is not a man. If you haven't got any enemies, there's something wrong with you, boy. You ought to have friends, you ought to have enemies. People ought to be able to tell you by your friends and tell you by your enemies. I read the King James Bible, the Word of God, because of the pride and inconsistency of its critics. Dr. John R. Rice, in writing to a dear soul up in Myrtle, Mississippi that I knew, wrote her and said, "As for Acts 8:37, you may prefer to leave it in or you may prefer to take it out. It never seemed to me like part of the Word of God." Imagine John R. Rice writing that to a saint in the Lord after putting out the sword of the Lord attacking the Southern Baptist Convention for infidels in the seminaries. What a hypocritical thing. What a desperate bunch of wickedness. Better write all this stuff against the Southern Baptist compromise, and tell a dear saint of the Lord, you may prefer to take it in, to leave it in, or you may prefer to take it out. I knew that old sister up there, and of course I didn't know her till later. At that time she didn't know me, the woman up in her 80s, and she had written John Rice a letter criticizing him for recommending the ASV, and she pointed out to him mistakes in an ASV, and he wrote her back a letter and said, "You would have known there were any mistakes in an ASV unless you've been hanging out with bad company." And he said, "Your trouble is you listen too much to Peter Ruckman, and if you don't quit reading his books, then you'll get talking bad and using bad language like he does too." And that dear old saint wrote him back and said, "Dear Brother Rice, I never read Peter Ruckman, don't know who Peter Ruckman is. I wrote to you because my father was a preacher and you reminded me so much of him." What a thing, man. What a thing. We had a fellow in our school this year give a testimony. He was up at Tennessee Temple. They called him in there and said, "You're a Ruckmanite." He said, "What's that?" "With the King James Bible, the Word of God." He said, "Yeah, I believe that." They said, "You've been following Ruckman." He said, "I don't know who Ruckman is. Never heard of Ruckman." They hold out a clipping they took out of the Bible Baptist Bulletin called "The Creed of the Alexandrian Cult." This is Faulkner and Jennings up there, and Affman and Martin, and wave it in his face and said, "You see this? You see this? This is about us. This is about us."
Amen.
Thank you for that word of testimony. I intended the hit dog to yell when he got hit with a rock. You say, "What are you drawing up there?" "I'm drawing your picture of a bridge." You say, "Where's the bridge going?" "Well, it's going over here." It's pointing the way to absolute truth. Christ says, "Thy word is truth." Not a truth, not truths. Thy word is truth. But you got to cross the bridge, you see. And if you don't go over the bridge, you break your neck and fall down in the gully. And this bridge is being condemned. You see, people don't want you walking over this here bridge.
And that's the way.
You know what Robert Sumner said about the translation Luke chapter 1? He said the King James translators in Luke chapter 1 made an unpardonable blunder. That a proud, conceited ass. Here's Kenneth Wee saying the King James translators made all these mistakes in their translation and their punctuation is the wrong place. They made the wrong punctuation. I picked up Kenneth Wee's translation, New Testament, called the Expanded Translation. When I picked that thing up, I found over there when he got to John chapter 5, he changed the verse numberings so you would think he had 8 verses in the first 8 verses. No, they had the 6 verses in the first 8 verses. The fellow took 2 verses and knocked them clean out and then numbered the verse down the side so you'd think he hadn't left out a verse. Mafia. I got more respect for John Dillard, honest to God. That bunch. Why, a fellow out there who's a crook's got an alibi. But you save people in charge of teaching and preaching the Word of God. What alibi have you got for carrying on like that? Oh, my, what pride. Oh, what stuffed shirts. I've got ads back there in my thing piled up in the sword of the Lord. Learn the original Greek text. See what the original Greek text says. There isn't a man that ever lived on this earth that ever saw the original Greek text. And if you saw the original Greek text, you couldn't tell what it said anyway. You can't get it in your own language. How are you going to get it in Greek? Tell me what this means, brethren. Tell me something. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. That's in your language. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. You believe that? How many of you believe it? Any care to explain it? You still sin? Why do you sin if you can do all things through Christ? Think the Greek can help you out? I never seen such pride and inconsistency in all my life. There are verses in there that you'll never understand. You live through them and go through them, and no amount of education, the Greek will tell you nothing. Nothing. How many of you owe money right now? Let me see your hands. How many about to declare bankruptcy? Let me see your hands. All right. My God shall supply all your needs through the riches and glory of Christ Jesus. You think a Greek will help you? I believe the King James Bible is the Word of God because of the pride, inconsistency of its critics. My, what a proud bunch of self-righteous people. We had a fellow here in town one time, his name is Richard Taylor. I mean, he got saved over there at Brent Baptist Church and got called to preach over there, and we sent him off to Bob Jones. Back in those days, we didn't have a Bible Institute, and a young fellow get called to preach, I'd just send him off to Bob Jones at Tennessee Temple. And after they all came back in, for those, the Lord got me in a corner one day and said, aren't you kind of stupid? I said, what do you mean? He said, every time I call a young man to preach on him, you send him off to school, and he comes back denying the Word of God. We sent Rick Taylor off there to school, and he went off to Bob Jones, became a professor at Bob Jones, and got in there, and then one day he came back to Pensacola, and he went down the street corner Saturday afternoon and saw some of our young men preaching down there, and just got him all shook up, because he hadn't been preaching the street. He quit. He wasn't winning the soul. He quit. And he kept alongside one of our young men, and he said, you're a Ruckmanite. Our young man said, what's a Ruckmanite? And he said, you believe that King James Bible is the Word of God? He said, I sure do. He said, that is, no, you don't believe it has any mistakes in it. The kid said, that's right, I don't. And he said, Ruckman taught you that. You're following a man. And this kid said to him, he said, you believe it does have mistakes? And Rick Taylor said, yes, I do. And he said, what man are you following? Who taught you that? I know who taught him that. The faculty at Bob Jones taught him that. Here you go. What is the inspired Word of God? Faith Magazine for the Family. For the family? I don't want my family reading that trash. For the family? Neither the received text nor the Westcott-Nort text are right or wrong. Both are the Word of God. The Westcott-Nort text is nearer to the original and therefore is older and better. But both are the Word of God. No version is inspired except to the degree that it conforms to the original meaning of the words of the original manuscripts. The ASV and the New ASV are efforts by conservative textual scholars at faithful translation. They are the result of a continued desire of faithful textual scholars devoted to the inerrant, infallible, inspired, preserved, and divinely transmitted Word of God to make use of the results of newest manuscript discoveries and the increased knowledge of the meaning of the Koine Greek. World Congress of Fundamentalism, Bob Jones University, advertisement for the suckers. The theme of the Congress will be the authority of Scripture. You just said the Westcott and Hort was the best one and closest, the oldest originals. You just recommended two versions to die the deed of Christ in five places. Now you're going to talk about the authority of Scripture? The theme of the International Gathering of Bible Believers. What? That's the first time that phrase ever occurred in Bob Jones University of Literature for 35 years. Now they're calling them Bible Believers. My, my, my. Which will stress the importance of biblical separation. International Committee for the Propagation and Defense of Biblical Fundamentalism. Let's see how biblical they are. Dear Bob, written to Bob Jones University from one of his graduates in California. It was shocking to read your letter of December 15th to Mr. Bob Elliott, a deacon in my church. It was even more shocking to learn that you sent copies of your letter to another deacon of our church and to a student at BJU who was the fiancé of another one of our church members. In the opinion of two attorneys who have examined your letter, you are guilty of having published several libelous statements about me. In fact, they are the opinion that your letter constitutes libel per se. Attorney John B. Furey, in his March 11, 1983 letter, wrote, "It is my opinion the December 15, 1982 letter from Bob Jones III, President, to Bob Elliott, constitutes actionable and recoverable libel per se." You wrote, "Rasmussen has slandered and vilified his alma mater. This is a falsehood." You wrote, "He has said we are proving apostasy. That's the lie of the century." You wrote, "He, the pastor, has lost his reason." You wrote, "He, his mean streak has erupted." You wrote, "He has no regard for the truth." You wrote, "Your pastor has asked the unreasonable and the impossible of Dr. Cust in this institution." You wrote to my church members, "It was terribly inconsiderate of your pastor to even bring up the matter of Westcott and Hort." One of the few statements in your letter which I consider to be correct was the statement that Stuart Custer is trying to set the record straight and to his reputation of being a defender of heretics. It is my judgment, view of all this documentation which I have sent to you and Stuart, proving Dr. Westcott and Hort were heretics, Custer has a monumental task ahead of him. Bob, I still regret that you refused to meet with me as I requested when you were in the immediate vicinity of our church for a week last summer. I decided to discuss the whole issue with you and face you in a brotherly way. There's Bob Jones III cutting down a pastor to his members by sending letters to the members, turning them against the pastor and writing libel to him. And when he's in the town where the guy is, he won't be with the guy and talk with him. And you're going to have a Congress on the authority of Scripture? You dirty, two-faced, lying, tricky, fort-tongued rascal! And that goes for all your friends and supporters. And some of you and your relatives. Dear Brother in Christ, on March 17th, I wrote to Bob Jones III and said, "Bob, I still regret that you refused to meet with me as I requested when you were in the immediate vicinity of our church." In this letter of March 23rd, Bob Jones replied, "If you will repent, I will forgive you, and then I'll talk with you." It is perfectly clear that Dr. Stuart Custer, who is now widely known as the theological voice of Bob Jones University, refused to admit that Dr. Westcott and Hort were heretics. Dr. Custer, in the opinion of an increasing number of Bible-believing theologians, is mistaken, as is Dr. Bob Jones III, in his assertion to Dr. Rasmussen, in assisting that Dr. Custer and Bob Jones University call Westcott and Hort heretics, is asking the unreasonable and the impossible. That's a correspondence that goes into a sheet of papers that high, mailed out to 22,000 pastors. You say, what did Bob Jones Jr. do about the charges that pastor brought against him? Nothing. You know why he couldn't? Because that old boy lied about that pastor from the first letter to the last letter and refused anything about it and put on a show and said, "We believe in the absolute authority of the Bible," when he believed nothing of the kind. I don't think that Vito Genovese and Al Capone and Pretty Boy Floyd and Alvin Karpis and Homer Van Meter and Nick Pacetti and Bellacci, I don't believe those fellows were any worse characters. As far as I'm concerned, that's just immoral, unethical slop. I could just much out at a nightclub at 4 o'clock in the morning, listen to a rock band play with the drinks on the table. You're welcome. You tolerate it. You tolerate it because you don't know the damage it's doing. I want a young man here. If there's a young man here, is there a young man here who believed the King James Bible was the Word of God, was almost talked out of his belief in it, and it caused him to backslide? Would you stand up? There's one right there. There's two right there, there's three right there, there's four there's five there's six there. Now what do you want me to do? talk nice about these fellows and tell you I'm given to overstate when I say that they're as bad as the mafia and the syndicate, they're worse! Amen. That bunch of crooks will rob you of your money and your life, but they wouldn't take the Lord from you and your book from you and your testimony. No. They wouldn't take your conscience from you. They wouldn't wreck you for 50 years spiritually. If I didn't have any burden for young men, I wouldn't care. I'm concerned about young men. You say, why? I've sent enough of them to hell. And I'm not going to stand around and see somebody else do it. If I've got a claw, I can put in. If I put it in, boy, I'm going to stick it. It's going to hurt. I'm a little fella, see? I'm a little fella. But I got big feet. They're 9 triple E. Now, if you kick them, it'll hurt them. I believe the King James Bible is the Word of God because of the pride, the inconsistency of its critics. And last but not least, I believe the King James Bible is the Word of God because of the preeminent place it gives the Lord Jesus Christ. I've had plenty of time to study all kinds of translations. I never saw a new translation of any kind anywhere that somewhere didn't attack the deity of Jesus Christ. While the ASV attacked the deity of Christ in Luke chapter 2, verse 33, it attacks the deity of Christ in 1 Timothy chapter 3, 16, it attacks the deity of Christ in Acts chapter 4, verse 27, and so does the new ASV, and so does the RSV, and so does the new RSV. You say, what about the New King James Bible? The New King James Bible attacks the deity of Christ in Acts chapter 4, 27. In Acts chapter 4, 27, it said that Jesus Christ was not God's child, he was just God's servant. I don't believe that. I believe he was God's child. Now watch this thing right here. This is a condemned bridge. You know what it's condemned by? Well, it's condemned by atheists. And Catholics. Birds of a feather flock together. It's condemned by fundamentalists. That's why they wanted a new one. It's condemned by agnostics. It's condemned by communists. As a matter of fact, it's condemned by just about everybody. You know what I find? I find if you take that old book and open that old book and pray over that book and read that book and believe that book, you get the answers you're looking for. It's the bridge to absolute truth. You know what I have against these fellas? The thing I have against them is they lie. They lie. They lie. They lie. They lie. I don't like a man who habitually lies. I put up with it occasionally. I mean, I know people. You lie about something. But about the Word of God? My, my, my. I can't give his name, but I invited a professor of one of the strongest fundamental schools in the country to be here for a Baptist blowout in January. And he phoned me up on the telephone and said he couldn't come. I said, why? He said, I don't want any publicity, but they threatened to fire me if I came. They called him in and threatened to fire him if he came here to be at the school. What a bunch of dirty, rotten, low-down, cheap, good-for-nothing, sorry, backslidden, wretched, hypocritical bunch of... Why, if some of you had a chance to go preach to some other school or some other church, you think I'd say, oh, I would... Brother McGee gets an invitation to preach at Tennessee Temple. You got to call him and say, you preach at Tennessee Temple, going to get fired. Folks, if you're not going to believe me, will you sit down and consult with your own mind? What's the difference? There's a difference. I don't handle things like these people handle them. Somebody's wrong. I'll give you one guess. Just keep on, you'll get the message after a while. Why Evans wrote John R. Rice one time for a debate and said, would you debate with Dr. Peter Ruckman about the King James Bible? And he wrote back and said, no, I can have no fellowship with Brother Ruckman because the Bible says you're not to keep company with an angry and furious man. And Evans wrote him back and said, I didn't ask you to have fellowship with an angry and furious man. I asked you to debate with Brother Ruckman. Hey, man, how about one time all 52 face up, okay? But you got something to hide? Well, you know what I have against these fellows? They won't tell the truth. They won't tell the truth. Here, a couple of years back, I let a drunk the Lord here in town. He pulled me up in the middle of the night crying, told me to come over and talk with him. And I got over there and came to his house. When I came to his house, he and his wife both been drinking. When I came to the house, I hadn't seen this guy for 30 years. Before I was saved, you used to know him. When I came in the house, he came up to me crying and said, "Pete, show me Jesus, show me Jesus." Well, you have that put on you without a moment's notice. I just happened to have on me one of those color cartoon tracks, so tell it like it is. I flipped it open, there was Christ on the cross, right in front of the blood running off him. That old boy broke down. Knelt down there, got saved, and after he got saved, he got up and said, "Now, tell my wife, lead her to Christ." And she was sitting there in a state of shock. She's an Episcopalian. She was there in a state of shock, and I said, "Well, now, are you saved?" She said, "Well, I've been confirmed." I said, "I was confirmed, too, before I was saved." And she said, "Well, I had a godfather and a godmother." I said, "So did I, before I was saved." And she said, "Yeah, but we studied catechism." I said, "I did, before I was saved." And she said, "But," and that drunk began to laugh. The guy just got converted. He just laughed, and he said, "See there, I told you Pete Ruckman tell you the damn truth." That's what he said. That may have, I didn't say that. I quoted this fellow saying that. Some of these folks. Now listen, some of you thin-skinned folks, you don't understand that, do you? I understand it. Listen. I consider that a greater compliment than if I'd gone to Bob Jones and been given an honorary doctorate. I knew what that old drunk meant. He meant I can count on Ruckman. He won't lie and try to mess around. He'll tell him the truth. Now, I don't call it the damn truth, see? I don't call it that. I call it the blessed truth. But I know what he meant. I'd rather have that guy's commendation than any PhD in this country. I mean it. I've got a big word of what I'm saying. What the trout fellows are, they're not man enough to obey. They're not man enough to speak out. They're not man enough to speak the truth. That's the problem. You know what A.V. Henderson said recently? A.V. Henderson, the president of Bible Baptist College, said to a friend of mine, "I think in the next generation, people won't even use the King James Bible, and it won't bother me if they don't." What a thing for the president of a Baptist college to say to a young bunch of preachers that are studying for the ministry. Years ago down, let me read these fellows say, here's General MacArthur. "Never a night goes by, if ever, so tired, but I read the Word of God before I go to bed." How do they read it if you don't have it? General Patton, "Keep your feet clean, read your Bible." Hoover, "The Bible is the unfailing guide which points the way for men to the perfect life." Here's Billy Graham, 1949, at the end of his route down the little old college down there in South Florida, Trinity College, and he, after the professors tried to talk him out of the Word of God, he went out in the bushes and knelt down and prayed over his Bible and said, "Father, I cannot understand many things about this book. I cannot come intellectually all the way, but I accept it by faith to be the authoritative, inspired Word of the living God." Had a King James Bible open there, kneeling on it. What happened to Billy? Somebody must have talked him out of it. Here's Criswell. Quote, "The preacher who starts for the Word of God in his hands, how do you have in your hands if the original manuscript, if it's the original manuscript? How do you have in your hands if it's the ASV or the new ASV or the Textus Receptus or the Westcott and Hort? Who has the Word of God in his hands stands upon an invincible, impregnable rock. When the Bible is the infallible Word of God, God writes it down, and we can open the sacred book and read its holy words." What happened to Criswell? I believe everything I read there. Did those fellows believe it? Well, if they didn't, they lied. And you want to quit lying. Jerry Powell, quote, "No human being has the right to change what God said." Amen? Amen. We teach here, Ruckmanite. "Our faith, our ministry as a New Testament church finds its premise in this English Bible. Whenever you are reading something beside this book, be sure it agrees with this book or it isn't worthy of your reading time." Amen? Amen, amen, amen. What happened to Falwell's faculty? Somebody backslid. Somebody dropped off the deep end. Years ago down in Panama City, I knew Brother Larson's father. Name of Lee, wasn't it? Lee Larson? And one time he was principal school down there that Hugh Pyle had at Central Baptist Church. The boy and a fellow named Otis Holmes. And I got fooling around that thing, and his daddy, Lee Larson, friend of mine, had a meet one night, and he said, "I want to have you put in this school charter here, in this constitution, We believe the King James Bible is the Word of God, and it doesn't contain the Word of God. It is the Word of God preserved without error. And I had a big go-around about it and decided not to do it. About that time, Jack Hiles and John R. Rice came down to Hugh Pyle's church for a meeting, Central Baptist Church. And this back in the days when Hiles wasn't as sure of himself as he is now. We had to kick him around a while to get him on the right track. When he came down there, Hugh Pyle, a very tactful fella, he is, and a gentleman, that's more I'm safe than myself, he called Jack Hiles and Rice there and had him talk with Brother Larson's daddy. And they sat down there and tried to convince him the King James had mistakes in it. And Brother Larson's daddy said, well, it says over there in the book of Revelation this and that. And Rice got mad and said, it also says, you got to keep his commandments. And the King James translator were Episcopalians, Arminian, and thought you could lose it. And a man couldn't be saved and believe that passage and stand the King James Bible. And his daddy said, well, I believe it. And pointed out some other mistakes. And Rice got mad, got up and left the room. After he left the room, Jack Hiles said to him, now you shouldn't have rebuked an elder like that. And Larson's daddy said, I wasn't rebuking him, I was just showing him the mistakes in it. And Hiles said, well, be that as it may, John Rice our captain, and we're going to follow him. And Brother Larson's daddy said, I thought Jesus Christ was the captain of our salvation. And Hiles said, that's the first mean thing you've said to me this evening. Brethren, I don't care what Bible you read, I don't care what Bible you buy, I don't care what Bible you use, I don't care what Bible you preach. I'm an American. I believe in freedom. Amen? Preach anything you want. If you all believe a living Bible is the Word of God, help yourself, brother. It's your neck, not mine. I ain't going to worry about it. I have just one thing against the brethren. Just one thing. Just one thing. I am sick and tired of a fellow standing where I'm standing and waving a book around he doesn't believe and telling a bunch of Christians this is the Word of God when the dirty, lying scum doesn't believe it. Now, if he doesn't believe it, let him say he doesn't believe it. And if he does believe it, let him say he believes it. And you guys that come here to go to school, don't you ever. You do, I'll hunt you down and find you and roast your hide, boy. Don't you ever, anywhere, stand any pulpit and wave any book around telling it's the Word of God if you don't believe it. If you don't believe it, get out of the pulpit or get a book in the pulpit. You believe it's the Word of God. And if you don't, shut your mouth. And don't you lie. And if you do, the big bad boogeyman will get you if you don't watch out. All right, let's stand for prayer. I reckon that's enough. Kept you long enough tonight. How many got a King James Bible? Raise it up. Let me see it.
Amen, Dr.
Ruckman. All right. That's the Word of God, and those are the words of God.
Amen.
You see what am I to do with them? You're to read them. You're to believe them. You're to love them. You're to memorize them. You're to preach them. You're to teach them. You're to put them in practice. And brethren, someday if we have to die for what God said, we won't be the first ones. There's a long army ahead of us. If you have to die by it, die by it. Father, bless us. Help us to be true to your word. Help us never to doubt it. Help us to claim its promises. Confirm its promises to us. Don't let us down. We look upon thee. We trust in thee. We have no hope in anybody but thee. We trust nothing but what you said. Confirm your word to us and call us to have confidence on the promises that you've caused us to trust in. For Jesus' sake, amen. 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 Well,